Well, good evening. It's great to have you here. We're so excited for this. I've been looking forward to being a part of this, and it's just a privilege to get to moderate this evening. As you know, we just had an apologetics conference, and the word apologetics is a Greek word. It's found in the Bible, and it means to give an answer or a reason, as the Apostle Peter uses it in 1 Peter 3:15. He says to give an answer or a reason for the hope that you have in Jesus Christ, and to do that with gentleness and respect. And so tonight, we want to talk about our hope, we want to talk about our faith, and we want to do that in gentleness and respect. And so I'm looking forward to tonight, and I'm looking forward to the dialogue that we can have together as we discuss these important issues. I think it is so important and so helpful in our culture today that we could come together and that we can discuss these important issues, because it is so easy to misunderstand one another and not dialogue. I was talking with Sadat earlier, and I know that he likes to travel, and so do I. And it reminds me of a time that my wife and I, actually at one point in our life, we quit our jobs and traveled the world for a year. And a large majority of our travels was in the Middle East. And I thoroughly enjoyed my time in the Middle East. But I remember in the Middle East, particularly where they spoke Arabic, they couldn't pronounce my name. They could pronounce my wife's name, Nancy, and no problem. I hear it's an Arabic name, but Andy, they just couldn't get it. So I figured, you know what? I'm just going to take on an Arabic name, you know? And so I traveled the Middle East, like seriously, I traveled the Middle East calling myself Alibaba. It's the only name I could think of. And so in many places around the world, I'm known as Mr. Baba. But I get that idea of how we can misunderstand each other, how we can miscommunicate. And I, by the way, I didn't know, like, the name just came to you. I didn't know that he's a mythical character that was really wealthy. And here I am, this white guy traveling around. So hey, he's the Alibaba. But I'm looking forward to this because it's so easy for us to misunderstand each other. So tonight's an opportunity for clarity. As was mentioned, the topic of tonight is, we're speaking on the Bible or Quran, which contains the Word of God. We have two men here, and I have asked each of them to send me their bio, and then they sent me what they would like read, and so that's what I'm going to read for you tonight about who these two are, and then I'm going to tell you a little bit about the debate, and then we're going to jump right into things. So the first that I'm going to introduce you to is Tony Costa. Tony has earned a BA and an MA in the study of religion and biblical studies and philosophy from the University of Toronto. Tony received his PhD in the area of theology and New Testament studies from Radboud University in the Netherlands. He is a member of the Society of Biblical Literature and the Evangelical Theological Society and the Evangelical Philosophical Society. His area of expertise is biblical and systematic theology, cults, New Age movements, and comparative world religions with a specialization in Islam. Tony is also an ordained minister of the gospel. As a Christian apologist, Dr. Costa gives reasons for the valid belief in Christianity and also advocates the unique claims of Jesus Christ. He also lectures and debates at various universities and colleges on the existence of God as well as the credibility of the Christian faith. Tony is a professor of apologetics with the Toronto Baptist Seminary. He also teaches as an instructor with the School of Continuing Studies at the University of Toronto in the area of New Testament studies. He serves as an adjunct professor with Heritage College and Seminary in Cambridge, Ontario, and Providence Theological Seminary in Franklin, Tennessee. Tony is also a fellow with the Ezra Institute for Comparative Christianity in Canada. He has lectured throughout Canada, the United States, and overseas. He is the author of Worship and the Risen Worship and the Risen Jesus in the Pauline Letters, as well as a contributor of scholarly essays in Christianity, Origins in Greco-Roman Culture, and Christian Origins in Hellenistic Judaism and various journals. Tony is happily married to a wonderful wife and has three children and a grandson and resides in Toronto, Canada. That's Tony Costa. Sadat Anwar is a member of Muslim Debate Initiative, MDI, based in London, England. Born and raised in Toronto, Canada, he graduated from the University of Toronto in the area of Mideastern Studies. He's active in interfaith dialogues and discussion circles. Also, he's a member of Street Dawah Toronto, which does Muslim outreach in Dunnas Square. I'm not from around Toronto. Did I say that correctly? Dundas Square, Toronto, every Sunday afternoon. I'm from Vancouver, British Columbia, and so I'm a little new around here. I'm looking forward to hearing from both of them tonight. This debate is going to go really fast, so let me just share with you how it's going to go. We're giving two introductory talks of 15 minutes each, and then they will both have rebuttals of 10 minutes each, and then they will have conclusions of 5 minutes each. We have a timekeeper down below in the front row that will be showing each of them how much time they have remaining, and once they get to zero, I will intervene and ask them to please stop. As well, at the end of that, we will have a time of Q&A that will be 30 minutes in total. I will allow each of them 2 minutes each to respond to the question. Now, you may have noticed we don't have microphones up here to take questions, and the reason for that is because we've got this. So if you have your brochure that you got when you came in, if you could just grab it for me, I want you to turn it over, and I want you to take a look at the back, and I just want to explain it to you for a moment. On the back, you'll see at the top is instructions for Q&A participation. This is something that we've often done, is we use this software called Pull Everywhere. It's a great software that helps us to facilitate questions and allows us to go through those questions more quickly. So I will be up on the stage, and you'll see me looking at my phone. I'm not zoning out. I'm not texting my wife. I'm looking at your questions that you're sending in. And I will organize those questions, and then I will be asking them of our two speakers tonight. So you'll notice there you have three ways in which you can ask a question. You can text in a question, and to do that, just listen carefully, this is all you need to do. You need to text to the number 37607. You text thinking 2016, and you send that one time. After you do that, you're kind of logged into the system, then you can text your question to that number, 37607. Does that make sense? Great. Now, if you're a Twitter person, you can tweet in your question at @NCSUToronto. Or if you'd like to go onto the web, you can go on with your phone, go onto the web, and at pollev.com/thinking2016, you can submit your question. If you forgot everything I said, it's just there. You can read that. And so while they're speaking, I would encourage you to pull out a phone, your tablet, whatever you have, and text in your question, and I will be facilitating those from the front. So, to start with our first introduction of 15 minutes, Dr. Tony Costa. Thank you.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's such a pleasure to be here. I want to thank all the organizers who made this event possible. I also want to thank my good friend, Sadat Anwar, for being here and sharing the podium with me tonight and discussing this very, very important topic. And to all our Muslim friends, I bid you a wassalamu alaikum. Now, tonight we're going to be dealing this question, the Bible or the Quran. And obviously, I'm going to say something about the Quran as well. And I'm sure Sadat also will be sharing. But when we talk about the Bible, we're talking about not necessarily one book. We're talking about a divine encyclopedia composed of numerous books that have different genres, different types of literature. Some of the Bible is narrative. Some of it is prophetic. Some of it is poetic. Some of it contains what we call apocalyptic literature and so forth. And so the Bible is not just one book. It is a collection of books composed of both Old Testament and New Testament. This book came down to us over a 1,600-year period, and it came to us through three human languages, namely Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. It was written by over 40 different authors. Many of these authors did not know each other. They lived in different time periods. And many of these authors lived in different areas, different geographical locations. And the amazing thing about this book that we call the Bible is that the way it came together, the way it was collected, the way it was collated, and the message that it contains. Now, tonight I want to show that the message and the worldview of the Bible is drastically different from that of the Quran. The Bible is a book about the Creator God, who made humans, made them perfect, made them in his image, and that this God presented in the pages of Holy Scripture is a covenant-keeping God. He is a God who enters into and desires to enter into relationship with his creatures. And that this God binds himself to what we call covenants. And in these covenants, God desires to have a personal relationship with the creature. And we see that the biblical narrative that begins with Genesis begins with this perfect couple, Adam and Eve. And then the Bible records that a cataclysmic event took place where the fall occurred, what we call the fall. And this led to a severance in the relationship between God and his creation. But that was not the end of the world. This God promised that he would send a redeemer. And we find that first messianic promise in the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verse 15, that one would come who would remedy this severance between God and his creatures. The Bible then begins to focus on this redeemer, and you begin to see it building up as we move through the Old Testament and as we move towards the New Testament. God reveals that he is going to send someone who would be the seed of the woman. Later, we're told he'd come from one of the lines of Noah, his son Shem. And then God enters into a covenant with a man by the name of Abram, who is, his name is later changed to Abraham. And then Isaac, and then Jacob, and then the prophets speak of one who was to come from the royal house of David. So the Bible presents us with this covenant-keeping God who loves his creation and a God who seeks to save his people. And this development finds its fruition in the person and coming of Jesus Christ. And so the Bible, for all intents and purposes, is a Christocentric book. It is focused on the person of Jesus Christ. In fact, in the New Testament, when we come to the New Testament, this is exactly what we find with Jesus. Jesus understands that his mission is to come to seek and to save that which was lost. And in fact, if you look at his name, in Hebrew, his name is Yeshua, and in the Greek, it's Jesus. The very name that he bears tells us something about his character. He was given the name Yeshua because we're told he shall save his people from their sins. Now, this is extremely central to the biblical message because the coming of Jesus in the Bible is a mission whereby he comes to procure the salvation of God's people. And in fact, not only does the Bible say that he came, but that Jesus was willing to give his life as a ransom for his people. Now, the concept of sacrifice is extremely central to the biblical message. It is part of the majority of what we call the Pentateuch. The first five books of Moses are concerned about the sacrifices that God had commanded the people of Israel to perform, to make atonement, and so forth. And we have to understand that the prophets would later pick up on this. And the prophet Isaiah could speak about this suffering servant who would pour out his life as a guilt offering for God's people and so forth. Jesus in the New Testament understands that mission. In fact, in Luke 24, we're told that Jesus said that everything written about me in the law and in the prophets and in the writings must come to fulfillment. And in fact, they did come to fulfillment. And so that's the biblical narrative. God is a covenant-keeping God. God is also a God who enters into his creation. And one of the central aspects of the Christian faith is that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that is a major, major theme in the biblical timeline. Now, when we go to the Quran, what we notice is the Quran makes some claims for itself that I cannot accept, and I'll explain why. The Quran rewrites the whole narrative. The biblical narrative is rewritten in the Quran. In fact, the Quran recasts all of the biblical figures or the biblical prophets as Muslims. They're all Muslims. And they're all pointing not to Jesus. In the Quranic narrative, they are all pointing to Muhammad. And so in Surah 3, verse 81, or chapter 3, verse 81 of the Quran, God enters into this covenant with the prophets. And he tells the prophets to not only submit to him, but to believe on the one who is to come and to aid this one who is to come. And in Surah, or chapter 61, verse 6 of the Quran, we have the Muslim Jesus predicting the coming of one who is to come, whose name is Ahmed. And this, of course, is taken as one of the names of Muhammad. So that in the Quran, you will notice, the focal point is not Jesus. The focal point is Muhammad, who is believed to be the seal of the prophets, the last of the prophets, and the Quran points back to the scriptures of the Al-Kitab, the people of the book, and the Quran makes the assertion that the figure of Muhammad, the unlettered prophet, is found and he is mentioned in their scriptures, namely in the Torah and the Injil, that is, in the Torah and the Gospel. And so the Quran then makes the claim that the prophet of Islam, the messenger of Islam, is predicted in the scriptures of the people of the book. And of course, the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians, when Muhammad came to Medina and told the Jews, I am the one who was spoken of in your scriptures, the Jews said, well, where are you predicted in the scriptures? This led to a lot of conflict in Medina between Muhammad and the Jews, who refused to accept his prophethood. And so the Quran then makes the claim that the previous scriptures are consistent with the message that the Quran brings. Now, the issue with the Quran as a text is that the Quran by itself is a closed book. If you were to read the Quran by itself with no aids whatsoever, you would not understand most of what it says, because in Islam, the meaning of the Quran is dependent on what we call the hadith literature, the sirah literature, that is the biography of Muhammad, the life of Muhammad, Sirah al-Rasul by Ibn Ishaq, and also the Kitab al-Maghazi by al-Waqidi. And these are considered the earliest biographies that we have of Muhammad. We don't know anything about Muhammad from the Quran by itself. In fact, the Quran only mentions Muhammad by name four times in the Arabic text. We would know nothing about his birth, nothing about his upbringing, his father's name, his mother's name. We would know nothing about him. And the problem here is that these source materials that undergird the Quran, like the Hadith and the Sirah, the Hadith, for instance, comes over two centuries after Muhammad. And the earliest biography that we have of Muhammad comes from about 150 years after him, written by Ibn Ishaq, but we don't even have his biography. It doesn't exist except in a very heavily edited version of that sirah written by Ibn Hisham about 200 years after Muhammad. And then Al-Waqidi's is also about 200 years after Muhammad. And this has caused some serious difficulties in terms of historical research. You have this material that comes very late, claims to be a biography of the Prophet of Islam, and yet we have issues with that. Scholars are very skeptical about these sources because of their late dating. Now, of course, one of the things that we know about the New Testament is that the New Testament has extremely early attestation. If I could quote here Professor Stephen Shoemaker of the University of Oregon, he says this, quote, the early biographies of Muhammad, the Sirah tradition, are not at all equal in their historical quality to the canonical Christian Gospels. Despite frequent assertions to the contrary, our historical knowledge concerning Muhammad and first century Islam is far more limited and uncertain than is the case with respect to Jesus and first century Christianity, close quote. And that's because the Gospels come to us about, the Gospels were written several decades after Jesus. The biography of Muhammad is, at the minimum, a century and a half later. Now, what's another reason why I don't accept the Quran as the Word of God? Well, the Quran makes the claim that it is purely a heavenly text. It comes down from the preserved tablet in heaven. There is no mortal speech. The Quran says there is the accusation of the kafir, the unbelievers, that say that this is nothing but mortal speech. The Quran responds to that and says, no, this is a heavenly revelation. And the issues I have with that is that when we study the Quran, what we notice is that a lot of its sources are, in fact, earthly in nature. The Quran, for instance, quotes from apocryphal Christian sources. The story of Jesus, for instance, speaking from the cradle, or Jesus creating birds out of clay and animating them. We know where these come from. In fact, they come from the infancy gospel of Thomas. The Quran says in Surah 53 that the unbelievers say to Muhammad, we've all heard this before. This is nothing but ancients of the tales of the ancients. We've heard all this before. The Quran responds by saying, no, you are the liars. This has been sent down by him who knows the secrets. But then when you start looking at the Quran, all of a sudden these stories pop up, like God raising Mount Sinai over the heads of the Jews and saying, accept the Torah or I will crush you. Well, we know where that comes from. It comes from the rabbinic writings that say exactly the same thing. The story of Allah commanding the angels to bow down to Adam, and then Iblis, the devil, refuses to do so. We know where that comes from. It comes from a Christian source called The Life of Adam and Eve, where the story is expressed in exactly the same way. And then we have other issues. For example, the second caliph, Umar, we're told that Umar would come up with these ideas or these phrases, like God is the best of creators, or he would say things to the effect that Gabriel is an enemy to the Jews and so forth. And these types of sayings appear in the Quran. In fact, Muslim sources admit this, that certain sayings of the companions of Muhammad would be spoken and then they would be put into the Quran. But I think the most serious allegation here is an event in Muhammad's life that has come down to be known as the Satanic Verses. And this is a story that is actually not found in Western academia. This story of Muhammad and the Satanic Verses actually comes to us from Ibn Ishaq. It comes to us from Al-Waqidi, from Ibn Sa'd, Al-Tabari. What it is the Quraysh, the pagan Arabs, Muhammad wanted to win them. And there were three daughters that they believed that Allah had. They're mentioned in the Quran, chapter 53, Alat, Aluz, and Manat. And in this story that is related by Al-Tabari, it's related by Ibn Ishaq, it's related by Ibn Sa'd, and some others, Muhammad says to them that these goddesses, Alat, Aluz, and Manat, are supposed to be intercessors, that they could function as intercessors, and that you can call upon them in your intercession with Allah. And then later we're told in the story that Muhammad realized that Satan had thrown these words into his mouth. Now, some Muslims will say, well, this isn't true, the narration is weak, this never happened, and so forth. But the fact of the matter is, folks, that no Muslim would invent such an embarrassing story. In fact, if we apply the principle of embarrassment, it's virtually impossible that a Muslim or any Muslim writer like Al-Tabari or even Ibn Ishaq would come up with a story like this. And there's actually a PhD dissertation that has been published actually by doctoral student, it's now published, Princeton University, where he deals with this very subject and actually argues that if you follow the Isnad tradition, the transmission tradition, it is accurate, it happened. And so if you're interested in that, I can pass that to you. There's only so much we can say in 15 minutes, but I try to communicate as much as I can. And I thank you for your time and for your consideration. And may God bless you.
Sadat now has 15 minutes. I have noticed that some of you are typing in essays for questions, and you're getting cut off, so I'm only receiving half of it. You really need to truncate your question. It needs to be very short. It needs to be to the point, 2 to 3 sentences max. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Tony, and Shukran Alibaba. If you think Dundas is hard, try Mississauga. I want to hear Americans say Mississauga before the night is over. Okay. So basically, I have 15 minutes to essentially give a sales pitch for the Quran. 15 minutes to give a sales pitch for the Quran to a Christian apologetics conference, which is kind of like, you know, trying to sell roast beef to a vegan festival. But all things are possible with God, so we'll try. Okay, so if we could please begin. What are some reasons that we should trust the Quran? Why should we trust the Quran as a revelation from God, as the words of God? Well, firstly, reason number one would be that it makes a direct claim of being from God. We have to at least begin our research with a claim. As Tony rightly pointed out, the Bible is not one book. It's a library shelf of many books. Therefore, we should require that each and every individual book should make some claim of it being divine revelation. We don't find that in the Bible. In the Quran, however, in chapter 15, verse 9, God says, "Indeed, it is I, God, who have revealed this reminder of the Quran, and it is I who will preserve it." Now, the claim by itself, of course, that's the whole dispute. So moving on to the second part of that claim, the claim is that God will preserve the Quran. God will safeguard the Quran. Is that a claim that we can test? Is that a claim that we could verify in any way? Yes, absolutely we can. Because the fact is that today in the world, there is only one Arabic Quran. 1 billion Muslims of every nation, of every language group, of every ethnicity are united on the same one scripture. You will never hear in the news, thank God, of Muslims fighting one another or disputing with one another over the canon of the Quran. That is a great blessing that Muslims have. That is a great blessing in Islam, because on the other side in Christianity, we do see that there are different groups of Christians who are in dispute over the canon of the Bible. Reason number two, and this is something very important to me personally, is that the Quran makes a very, it promotes a very clear and a very pure, a very easy to understand concept of the oneness of God. It's a concept that is so simple, that is so clear, that even children can understand it. I refer you to Surah Ikhlas, the chapter of sincerity, chapter 112 in the Quran. Qul huwa Allahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad, wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Say, He is God, the One, the Eternal, the Absolute. He does not beget, meaning He is not God the Father, He's not God the Mother, nor was He begotten. He's not God the Son, He's not God the Daughter. And there is nothing like unto Him. This is a very beautiful, simple, pure concept of the oneness of God. That God is one, period. No ifs, no buts. It's a concept of God that we're hardwired to want to believe in, to understand. Conversely, the concept of God in the Bible, especially in the New Testament, is one which is very complex. It's one which is very confusing, difficult to understand. To use the word that my Christian friends use, it's a mysterious concept that God is three persons, but the three are one. They're not three, but they're one. This is something that it seems to me we're hardwired to not understand. We're hardwired to want to reject it. And that's why at the end of the day, there are millions of Christian Unitarians, but there are no Muslim Trinitarians. Reason number three, the Quran's concept of divine justice and forgiveness is also natural. It's clear. It's easy to understand. What do I mean by the Quran's concept of divine justice and forgiveness? What I mean is very simple. In the Quran, God can do something which, at least according to evangelical Christians, God cannot do in the New Testament, which is that He can forgive without blood atonement. He can simply forgive. He can let go. If you ask Him to, if you repent to Him, if you say sorry. No one has to die. An animal doesn't have to die. A prophet doesn't have to die. God's son doesn't have to die. God doesn't require blood in order to forgive. He can simply forgive in the Quran, as we forgive one another when we wrong one another. Notice also that the Bible's concept of justice, divine justice and forgiveness is one which even Christians would not use in an everyday practical setting. So suppose that I had the power somehow to throw one of you into prison. And now you cry out to me and you say, what did you throw me into prison for? What did I do? What crime did I commit? And I say, no, you didn't commit any crime. But your great-great-great-grandfather, you see, he committed a crime. So I'm punishing you now as a substitutionary atonement. Here you would not resort back to the logic of Christian theology. You would not be satisfied by talk of vicarious atonement. No, you would cry out like any Muslim would cry out, like any Jew would cry out, and you would say, that's ridiculous. How can you punish me when I'm innocent? That's unjust. If anyone is to be punished, it should be the guilty party. Reason number four, Let us analyze the Quran by its own claims, as Tony was saying. The Quran makes a very tall claim. It says that it's inimitable, meaning that it cannot be copied, it cannot be replicated, it cannot be reproduced, due to its divine eloquence, due to its beauty. Now, this might strike us initially as a subjective criterion, because eloquence and beauty are in the eye of the beholder. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Is there any way that we could test this claim, that we could try to verify this claim in any way? Yes, there is. There is the verdict of history. The verdict of history is before us, that when the Quran posed its challenge, and in the Quran, God challenges the disbelievers and says, produce something like it. In fact, in chapter 17, God says, if the whole of mankind, if all the humans in the world and the spirits came together and tried to produce something like the Quran, they would not be able to do it. Even if they helped one another, even if they supported one another, they could not produce something like the Quran. What does the verdict of history say? The verdict of history is that there is no other Arabic book. There is no other Arabic work of poetry. There is no other Arabic story. There is no other Arabic prose writing that is as read, that is as recited, that is as venerated, that is as honored as the Arabic Quran. That's the verdict of history. Let us fast forward now to the modern era, however. There's an Arab Christian missionary. His name might be known to many of you. His name is Anis Sharosh. Anis Sharosh. Anis Sharosh, in 2008, Christian Arab missionary, he and a body of like-minded Christian Arabs came together and they produced a book, a scripture in Arabic called the True Furqan. The True Furqan. It means the true criterion. And they said, here you go. The Quran is saying that you can't produce anything like it. We've produced a book which is in eloquent Arabic. It's a Christian scripture because it's praising the Trinity and it's praising Jesus. And it's just as beautiful as what you have. Now again, what has the verdict of history been between 2008 and today, 2016? Tell me honestly, how many of you have heard of the book, The True Furqan? The one person I expected to hear about it has heard of it. So I think that itself is a verdict. I mean, even Christian Arabs haven't heard of it. Nobody reads this book. The book has been forgotten because it could not meet the challenge of the Quran. Reason number five, in the Quran, God says, and we, God, have certainly made the Quran easy to memorize. God is making a claim. We've made it easy to memorize. Is this a claim that we can test? Can we verify it in any way? Yes, we can. Two words for you. Google it. Google it, right? The most memorized book in the world. Most memorized book in the world. Today, there are hundreds of thousands of Muslims alive today who have committed this entire book of the Quran to memory. They can recite the entire book from the front cover to the back cover from memory. I'm going to get some flack from my Muslim friends after the debate, because they're going to say I shouldn't have said hundreds of thousands. I should have said millions. But I'm making a minimalist claim, hundreds of thousands of people. To bring that down to ground level, right here in Canada, you would have thousands of Muslims who have memorized the entire Quran. They can recite the entire book from beginning to end. So did God make the book easy to memorize? Yes, he did. More Muslims can recite this book than any Christians who can recite even a single book, even a single epistle, even a single letter of the Bible. So I hope you understand what I mean. And by the way, the majority of these Quran memorizers are non-Arab. Okay, go figure. Non-Arabs memorizing the entire Arabic Quran. Reason number six is that the Quran claims to bring new information, which was not known at the time. In chapter 11, verse 49, God says that this is from the news of the unseen, which we, God, have revealed to you, O Muhammad. You knew it not, neither you nor your people. Now, don't misunderstand this claim to mean that the Quran is claiming that everything in it is new. This is one of the mistakes, actually, that Tony has made, and I'll be addressing that in my rebuttal section. The Quran is not claiming that everything in it is new. The Quran, for example, teaches that stealing is wrong. Was this not known to people before the time of Islam? Of course it was. So the claim has to be understood to mean that some of the information in the Quran is new, and it could not have been known to Prophet Muhammad in 7th century Arabia. It's news from the unseen, from God. Can we test this claim in any way? Can we try to verify this claim in any way? Absolutely, yes, we can. In chapter 10, verses 90 to 92 of the Quran, God says to Pharaoh, this is the same Pharaoh during the time of Moses, when he's drowning, God says to Pharaoh, today I will save your body. You're going to perish, you're going to drown, but I'm going to save your body. Why? So that it might be a sign for future generations. Now the fact is that the majority of Bible historians believe that the Pharaoh at the time of Moses was Ramesses II. A minority believe that it was one of his sons, Merneptah. We have the mummy, we have the body of Ramesses II in the museum in Cairo in Egypt. For those who say that it was the other son, Merneptah, we have the mummy and the body of Merneptah as well in the same museum in Cairo, Egypt. Another example, reason number seven now is fulfilled prophecies. We would expect that a book claiming to be from God would make certain statements about the future, and then those statements would come to pass. Here is an example in chapter 110 of the Quran. Every Muslim knows it. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. God says, he consoles the Prophet Muhammad, and he says, when the help of God comes, and it will come, when the help of God comes, when the victory of God comes, then you will see people entering this religion. You will see people entering Islam by the multitudes, by the multitudes, by the troops. Was this prophecy fulfilled? Yes, it was. Within the very lifetime of the Prophet, peace be upon him, the whole of the Arabian Peninsula was politically united for the very first time in its history and had become Muslim. And a few years after his death, of course, the Islamic Empire conquered the Persian Empire. It was knocking on the doors of the Byzantine Empire, right? Today, even in the modern era, we see a double application of this prophecy, because don't we hear it all the time from the non-Muslim Western media? Don't we hear it from CNN all the time that Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world today? Was the prophecy fulfilled? Yes, it was. Another example of a fulfilled prophecy would be chapter 22, verse 27, in which Abraham is in Mecca, and God says to Abraham, proclaim among the people the pilgrimage. Announce the pilgrimage, the Hajj, to Mecca. They will come to you on foot and on every kind of transport, and from every distant track, from every distant route, they will come to Mecca. Was this prophecy fulfilled? Yes, it was. Everyone here knows millions of people flock to Mecca every year for the annual pilgrimage for the Hajj. In fact, I give to you the evidence of the English language itself, right? Open up the Merriam-Webster dictionary and look up Mecca. Mecca with a small m has become a naturalized word in the English language, which actually means a place that attracts many people. That's the meaning of Mecca in English today. That's why we say Wimbledon is a Mecca of tennis players. Right? Comic-Con is the Mecca for sci-fi fans. Las Vegas is a Mecca for gamblers. So the English language itself testifies to the fact that the Quran's prophecy did come true. And finally, for now, due to time, reason number eight, and you know, this is the most controversial one, is that the Quran claims to bring the truth about Jesus, and it claims to clear the wrong misconceptions that people have about Jesus. As you all already know, the Quran says that Jesus was not the Son of God. He was not God in the flesh. Christians have misunderstood him. Rather, he was a human prophet. He was a human messenger, a human Messiah, a human teacher sent by God. Now, obviously, we're not going to be able to verify that claim in the sense that we're not going to resolve this this dispute or this debate right here. But what I can do is I can try to draw your attention to the general
Sadat, you're out of time.
Oh, I have 14, 30.
Okay, go ahead for 30 seconds.
The general thrust of New Testament scholarship today is to bring into question many of the claims of divinity that are attributed to Jesus in the Gospel of John. I am the way and the truth, the Father and I are one, I am the Good Shepherd, etc. New Testament scholars today don't believe that the historical Jesus made these claims about being God or about being Yahweh. The point being that there is an amazing convergence between the findings of modern biblical scholarship and what the Quran has been saying to us for the past 1400 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Sadat. Tony now will be coming back up for his 10-minute rebuttal. So once he starts talking, we can start the time.
Thank you, Sadat, for those opening statements. And so I just wanted to confirm again that, as you could see, the biblical narrative in Islam is changed. There is clearly a change of focus, as we heard. So that's an observation that we find in the Quran. Now, Sadat was saying that the Quran claims to be a direct claim from God. Well, there are a lot of people who make direct claims from God. There's a lot of books that make direct claims from God. The Book of Mormon, for instance, makes a direct claim that it is inspired by God. But he did say something about preservation. And this is an area where modern scholarship has shown that far from the Muslim claim that the Quran is a preserved text, that is not the case at all. In fact, we do know from Islamic history that there were various variants in the text of the Quran. We know that the third caliph of Islam, according to the hadith, Uthman, standardized the text of the Quran and destroyed all other competing Qurans by burning them. We know that the Quran of Ibn Mas'ud, a close companion of Muhammad, had only 111 chapters in it, whereas the modern Quran has 114. The Quran of Ubay bin Ka'b, another companion, had 116 surahs. Where are those surahs today? We know that the Shias have a different view on things, that they believe that Uthman had corrupted the word of God by removing references to Muhammad's son-in-law, Ali, who they believed was to be the true successor. Now, Dr. Keith Small, in his book, Textual Criticism in Quran Manuscripts, it's a very important book, outlines the fact that we have Quranic manuscripts with different readings, with variant readings, as we call them. The Quran suffers the same transmissional corruption that we find in the New Testament documents as well. And this has been very well documented. In fact, Dr. Keith Small mentions in his book here that to date there has been no critical apparatus of the Quran. We have one for the Hebrew Bible, we have one from the Greek New Testament, but we don't have one for the Quran. Now, Sadat also said there was only one Arabic Quran, but in the history of Islam, there were as many as 14 readings of the Quran. And the Quran that he's referring to is the present one that most Muslims are familiar with. It's known as the Hafs edition, put out in 1924 in Cairo. And all competing editions were submerged in the Nile River. Remember earlier I said that Uthman ordered the destruction of all Quranic manuscripts after he standardized his text of the Quran. Now, why would you have to standardize something that has always been preserved? So scholarship today has actually shown us that if you look at the Sana manuscript that was found in Yemen, the Sana manuscript is very interesting. It's actually a palimpsest, which means that there was a text underneath the Quran text that was washed off and written over. And what professors like Keith Small and Gabriel Said Reynolds and Andrew Rippon and many others have found is that the reading underneath the current reading reads very differently. And even the order of the surahs are in different orders. So the idea of preservation is something that is seriously challenged by modern scholarship. Now, Sadat also said that the concept of the oneness of God is very simple. What does that mean, that Allah is one? Does it mean he is one in nature, one in person? Does it mean he's one in essence? What does that mean? Does it mean he's like the number one? What exactly does that mean? The oneness of God is indeed a complex issue. If we could fully understand God, then we are on the same level with God. And the Christian concept is that God is complex in his being, and that the problem with the doctrine of the Trinity and the sonship of Jesus is that the author of the Quran never fully understood what Christians believed about these doctrines. In the Quran, the charge is made that how can Allah have a son since he has no consort? I don't know any Christian here today who would believe that God has a wife and that God begot a son through a woman and called him Jesus. This was a serious misunderstanding on the part of Muhammad. And even when it speaks about the so-called Trinity, the Quran never mentions the word Trinity. It uses the word tathlith, the word for three, thalatha. And the idea of the three in the Quran is actually that Christians are worshiping Allah, Jesus, and his mother, Miriam, which again is a gross misinterpretation. So we have to ask the question, what does Son of God mean? I wrote two articles on this, which are available online, and the meaning of Son of God has no literal meaning to it in the biblical context, neither in the Old nor in the New Testament. So the other problem here as well is that we heard about the Quran cannot be imitated. And no one has been ever able to imitate the Quran. Well, that's quite a grand claim. But does that mean that because the text cannot be imitated, that it comes from God? It doesn't logically follow. I don't know anyone who's has rivaled William Shakespeare. I don't think anyone here believes William Shakespeare is a prophet of God and that we should be quoting Hamlet 3:16 and so forth. And I also don't think that Mozart, his music is absolutely unique. And Albert Einstein once said that Mozart's music is eternal. It was discovered, it was not created, and so forth. But does that mean Mozart, Amadeus Mozart, was a prophet of God? No, I don't think so. I think that the Quran actually uses a circular argument. It says, try to bring a surah like unto this surah. You may all try. Men and jinn may try to come together and to make a surah like this surah, but then the Quran says, but you can't do it. And so here's the issue. Why offer the challenge and then say you can't do it? And so I would challenge Arabic readers here to read Psalm 23 in Arabic, or read 1 Corinthians chapter 13 in Arabic, and compare it to one of the surahs of the Quran. Now Sadat says, well, there's a lot of people who know the Quran. Well, do they learn the Quran by heart volitionally, or is it because they're forced to learn that memorization? So I think the reason why they memorize it is because it has been part of the culture and the tradition. Now, the other thing that he said was that the Quran doesn't bring anything new. What I don't believe I've ever said that. What I have said is that the Quran claims to be consistent with the previous scriptures, and the Quran claims that all of its contents are from Allah. But what we have seen is that when we look into the contents of the Quran, there's a lot of material in the Quran that is clearly pre-Islamic. There are stories in the Quran that were known by the ancients, both Jews and Christians. And so when the Quran claims that everything within its contents has been sent down, that it has been revealed by Allah, then we have to ask the question, why then does the Quran replicate all these different stories? And so I don't think that the Quran, there's anything unique about the Quran. I don't think that its literary style is unique. In fact, Arabic scholars have noted that the Quran has a number of grammatical mistakes in it. And certainly if this was something from God, you would expect it to be without mistake. But there are mistakes in the case endings. Nominatives are used instead of accusatives, feminine used for masculine, and so forth. But I really would like Sadat, maybe in the rebuttal period, to maybe come back to the question that I raised earlier. And that is the story reported to us by Al-Tabari. It's also alluded to in Sahih Bukhari. And it's also alluded to by Al-Waqidi, the story of Muhammad. Actually capitulating, if you will, to the Quraysh, where he prays with them and makes mention of these three goddesses, this famous story that has come down to us as the Satanic Verses. Now, in Deuteronomy 18, it's very interesting. In that passage, we're told there that God is going to raise up a prophet like unto Moses. And this is one text that our Muslim friends usually quote to argue that Muhammad was prophesied in the Old Testament. But it's interesting that in that passage, there's a reference to a prophet who presumes to speak in my name. If that prophet presumes to speak in my name and speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die. And I think we have a serious issue here with the story of Muhammad and the story about this allusion to prostrating, mentioning these three goddesses, Alat, Al-Uzza, and Manat. And so I think it's clear that when we look at the Bible, the concept of atonement is extremely serious. As I pointed out at the beginning of Genesis, we already have this provision made by God that he was going to send one into the world. We see the whole Mosaic law comprises the concept of atonement. And I think the problem here is that our Muslim friends have not understood how seriously the Bible takes the concept of sin. That sin is a crime against God. And that sin is something that demands the justice of God. Is God merciful? Absolutely. We believe in the mercy of God. We believe that God forgives, but there's something crucial here, and that is the justice of God. And the gospel, the good news is this, that God loved us enough to send Jesus to pay the price that we cannot pay, to owe a debt that we cannot pay, and God vindicated him by raising him from the dead. And the good news is that you can come into this personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. You can have certainty of your sins forgiven. And this was the message of the early church. This was the message that the earliest Christian communities proclaimed. And this is backed up by all the historical evidence we have. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Sadat, you now have 10 minutes for your rebuttal. I'd also ask our Muslim friends that are here, we've gotten a whole lot more questions for Sadat so far than we have for Tony. If you guys could send in some questions, would be helpful to balance things out. Thank you.
And we still have that one question for you. How do you say Mississauga, right? At the end, I want to hear that. Okay. Okay, Tony said a lot about consistency. The Old Testament and the New Testament are consistent with one another. The Quran is an anomaly. It's different. It's inconsistent. It doesn't go with the Old and the New Testament. To some extent, of course, that's true, and Muslims would agree. But do the Old Testament and the New Testament actually agree? It depends. If you take, with respect, if you take the Jesus glasses off and you just look at the Old Testament objectively, look at what the Old Testament is actually saying. What is it saying? Numbers 23:19, God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man. God is not a man, he's not the son of man, that he should change his mind. In 2 Chronicles 6:18, God cannot dwell on earth. In 1 Kings 8:27, can God dwell on the earth? And then the answer is that no. How even the heavens cannot contain you, how much less this house that I have built. Malachi 3:6, God does not change. That's the Old Testament. That's the part Muslims actually agree with. But then when we fast forward to the New Testament, suddenly we hear in Colossians chapter 1, verse 9, God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, in Jesus. So Jesus is God on earth, God in the flesh. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, for in Christ all the fullness of the deity, all the fullness of God lived in bodily form. Does that sound like the Old Testament and the New Testament agree? Let's get a Jewish rabbi up here to give the answer. What will the answer be? No. And that is the reason why even historically that has been the position of medieval Jewish rabbis, that Islam holds to true monotheism, Christianity does not. Maimonides said, Moses Maimonides, like the Thomas Aquinas of medieval Judaism, he said, know that in every one of the Christian nation cities which has an altar, meaning their house of worship, it is a pagan house of idolatry without any doubt. That's not me talking. That's Maimonides talking. He's talking about this church right here. That's his position, that this is a place of idolatry because they worship a human being, which is not taught in the Old Testament. Tony talked quite a bit about how the God of the Bible is the God who keeps covenants. He's a God of covenants. Let me give you one counterexample. In Genesis chapter 17, verse 13, that is a covenant that is very, very important to those who keep the law of the Torah. That is the commandment of circumcision. And in Genesis 17, it says that circumcision, meaning circumcision of the males, is an everlasting covenant. It's an everlasting covenant. How long was that covenant kept in Christian times? Well, Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 19 says, circumcision is nothing. You know, don't worry about it. Circumcision is nothing. Meanwhile, Genesis 17 is saying, circumcision is an everlasting covenant in your flesh. It's not talking about spiritual circumcision of the heart. Tony mentioned the name Yeshua. He said that this is a central point that will help us understand who Jesus is, because Yeshua means Yahweh saves. That's fine, but Jesus is not the only person with the name Yeshua in the Bible. Joshua was Yeshua. You know, when you read the book of Joshua in the Old Testament, his name is Yeshua in Hebrew. So he had the same name as Jesus. It's not a big deal. Tony said a lot about the Sirah literature, which is the biographical literature about the Prophet Muhammad. And he said, we can't trust it because it came 200 years or whatnot after the time of Prophet Muhammad. The debate is not about Sirah literature. The debate is not about the biography of the Prophet. The debate is not about hadiths. It's about the Quran and the Bible. Now, maybe Tony brought up that point to just try to drive home that if we can't know much about the person who delivered the Quran to us, meaning Prophet Muhammad, then how can we trust the book? How can we trust the book when we don't know where it's coming from? I go back to my original point that I made in the introduction. If we treat the Bible as 66 separate books or 73 separate books, where do you find internal evidence in those books that they are revealed by God or that they are from God or even who wrote them? Who wrote the book of Job? Who wrote the book of Jude? Who wrote the letter to the Hebrews? Who wrote 1 John? Who wrote 2 John? We don't know. Tony quoted from chapter 61, verse 6 of the Quran, in which it's mentioned that Jesus prophesied the coming of a future prophet. And he said his name will be Ahmed. And Tony was saying that when we go back to the Bible, we don't find such a prophecy in the Bible. So Prophet Muhammad did not know the Bible, or he didn't understand because he made wrong statements about the Christian scriptures. But in chapter 61, verse 6, it does not say that Jesus said this and you can find it in the Bible. It doesn't say Jesus said this and you can find it in the Gospel of John. It just says Jesus said this. Did Jesus say anything outside of the four canonical Gospels? Of course he did. The ending of the Gospel of John itself testifies to that when the evangelist says that even if all of the oceans were ink, it would still not be enough to record all of Jesus' words and all of Jesus' actions and his miracles. Tony said that the Quran borrows from previous writings. It borrows from previous apocryphal texts and Jewish writings and things like this. One example that he gave was of the story of Jesus giving life to the clay birds in chapter 5, that's Surah Ma'idah, verse 110. And he said this is copied from the infancy gospel of Thomas, because the infancy gospel of Thomas also has this story. Now, this is the fallacy of false cause, that because B comes after A, it must have been caused by A, or it must have been copied from A. Another possibility is that they both have a similar source of information. Because the Quran is a heavenly book doesn't mean that it only contains heavenly information about angels and heaven and hell. It is talking about earthly historical events. And it would not be a surprise if other communities have recorded something about those historical events. Moreover, are you sure that the infancy gospel of Thomas existed during the time of the Prophet Muhammad? This is what Helmut Koester says in Ancient Christian Gospels. No final judgment about the original form and content of the infancy of the gospel of Thomas is possible. The earliest version of this gospel remains uncertain. So we're not even sure when it came from. The other thing is, if the Quran containing stories that are found in apocryphal writings means that we have to disqualify the Quran, it can't be the truth from God, then what would you say about the New Testament? What would you say about Hebrews chapter 11, verse 37, where it talks about That section, Hebrews 11:37, is believed by scholars to have been copied from the martyrdom of Isaiah. The martyrdom of Isaiah is an apocryphal writing. It's not found in the canonical Bible. What would you say about 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 8, where it talks about, Jannes and Jambres, they're fighting over the body of Moses, something to this effect. This information is not found in the Old Testament. It's found in apocryphal writings. Now, I will say a word about the satanic verses, because he asked me twice to do that. It's a very interesting approach that Tony took. He told us we can't trust At-Tabari because it comes too far after the time of Prophet Muhammad. But then he's asking us to trust Tabari and say, look, you know, Prophet Muhammad wasn't consistent because he compromised with the pagans, and he included some kind of praise about these pagan goddesses in the Quran. Now, the greatest Muslim scholars, as Tony alluded to, the greatest Muslim scholars, the medieval Muslim scholars, they all understood that this story does not have a proper isnad. So I am actually curious to know why you would argue for the isnad, because the isnad is mursal. It's missing the part of the chain which contains the companions. So someone is telling us that Prophet Muhammad did this, but he's not referencing it back to an eyewitness who could have heard this or seen this from the Prophet Muhammad. So the isnad is most definitely not sahih. It's not authentic. Al-Qurtubi, Qadi Iyad, Fakhruddin al-Razi, Ibn Arabi, al-Bayhaqi, all of them have rejected this. Modern scholars all reject this story of the satanic verses. Moreover, it doesn't make very good logical sense. If the disciples of Prophet Muhammad gave up, in some cases, their livelihood, they gave up their families, they gave up their security, they gave up their safety for the sake of the message that he was preaching in Mecca, which was very simple. There's only one God. All these other statues and idols that you're worshiping, they're false gods. There's only one God. If the disciples of Muhammad gave up their livelihood, security, safety, their homes for that message, would the Prophet Muhammad not immediately lose all credibility with them if he suddenly were to compromise and say, well, there's no God but God and his three daughters, that's okay? He would immediately lose all credibility. That's just illogical to believe that that story happened. These three goddesses would still be worshipped today if not for the actions of Prophet Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad sent Khalid bin Walid to destroy the main statue of Al-Uzza. He sent Abu Sufyan to destroy Al-Lat. He sent Sa'd bin Zayd to destroy Al-Manat.
I see that we're out of time.
Okay, all right, thank you.
We're into our final part of the debate. This is now the concluding remarks. Each person will have 5 minutes. Tony will go first. Thank you.
Okay, let me just respond to some of the claims that Sadat made, and then I will give my ending remarks. Now, a favorite passage that is quoted is Numbers 23:19, where it says, 23:19, where it says, God is not a man that he should lie. And this is a misunderstanding of the incarnation. Christians don't believe that God morphed into a human being, that he ceased to be God and simply became a human being. We believe that in the incarnation, God took on an additional nature. He took on flesh. And that is the decree of Scripture, that in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Through him, all things were made, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He quoted Colossians 2:9, and that's what it says. In him dwells the fullness of deity in bodily form. So that's not a contradiction to say that God can become man. The Numbers are saying God is not a man that he should lie. But God did enter into humanity in the person of Jesus. Now, he is in error when he says the Jews did not believe in this concept of plurality within God. That's an error. Maimonides, of course, comes in the 13th century, and he uses a completely different Hebrew word, yachid, for the oneness of God. The biblical word is echad. But up until the end of the second century, Dr. N.T. Wright and Larry Hurtado and many other New Testament scholars, and in my research field, I found this to be the case, there was a concept of plurality within God. And I would recommend maybe Sadat read Alan Segal's book, The Two Powers in Heaven, where he talks about the idea that the Jews, up until the end of the second century AD, had an understanding of God as a plurality within himself. And that's where the early Christians got this concept from. It came from Judaism. Rabbinic Judaism reacted to this and went into a strictly Unitarian mode. That's well documented. Genesis 17, of course, it mentions the covenant of circumcision. And the Hebrew word olam can mean forever. It could also mean for a very long period of time. The sacrifices are also said to be forever, or olam. But they had their fulfillment in the coming of the Messiah. Now he says, Joshua is called Yeshua as well. But that's not the point. The point is that Joshua was a type of the one who was to come. Joshua delivered the people into the land of promise. And he was a type of the one who would deliver us from our spiritual severance and our spiritual alienation from God. And so the meaning of Jesus means he shall save. And that's exactly what he came to do. He even openly admitted that. Now, the Old Testament also recognizes that God would enter into time. Isaiah 9:6 says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, El Gabor, Mighty God, Sar Shalom, the Prince of Peace, Ab Ad, Father of Eternity." And that's the same title, Il-Gabor, which is used in Isaiah 10:21 for Yahweh. The Messiah was to be Yahweh himself, Jeremiah 23:5-6. A righteous king shall arise out of the house of David, and this is his name, Yahweh Tzedkenu, Yahweh our righteousness. That's why in the New Testament, you will notice Jesus is identified with the Yahweh of the Old Testament. So when scriptures say, whoever calls on the name of Yahweh shall be saved, passages like that are applied to Jesus. Now, Sadat is also in grave error when he says, John doesn't believe in the divinity of Jesus, or excuse me, the other gospels don't believe that. But all you have to do is read Matthew 11:27 and Luke 10:22, and Jesus says, no one knows the Father but the Son, and no one knows the Son but the Father, and the Son reveals him to whoever he wishes. That's in Matthew. That's in Luke. And that is the language that one scholar said, it's like a Johannine thunderbolt that struck the Synoptic Gospels. Jesus used that language. Why? Because the Jews understood that God was Father. Whereas in Islam, this is even blasphemous to even conceive of God as Father. But Judaism understood God as Father. The early Christians understood God as Father. And Jesus' favorite title was Abba, for Father, for God. Now, when he was talking about the authorship of the New Testament, etc., authorship is not germane to inspiration. Who wrote Hebrews? It doesn't matter, because the canon of scripture is not defined by authorship. Who wrote the Quran? Well, it wasn't Muhammad. They say he was illiterate. But who wrote the Quran? Well, that is not germane to the concept of inspiration. And you see, the Quran claims that all of its contents come from God. The fact of the matter is that all of these other stories, it's not just Jesus making little birds from clay. Many other stories out there, Talmudic stories, Mishnaic stories, all of these stories are clearly pre-Islamic. And so the Quran does betray itself in that case. The satanic verses, the reason why I quoted Al-Tabari, Ibn Ishaq, and Ibn Abbas, is not to say, well, because they're late, we can't trust them. What I'm saying is there's multiple attestation for this story, and we have a very embarrassing situation here. The fact of the matter is, if Muhammad claimed to be a prophet, what is he doing addressing these goddesses? And so I think that we have to come back to the understanding that the biblical narrative squares itself on the person of Jesus and his centrality. And I invite you tonight, take up the New Testament, study it, and I think that the message of the New Testament will change your life as it changed mine. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Sadat, you have the final 5 minutes and our concluding remarks. So if you have any questions that you wanted to text in, please do those now. Remember to keep them to 3 to 4 lines, or I don't get it all. Thank you.
So like Tony, I'm going to use this time to do just a couple of more rebuttals. I'll finish with what I was saying about satanic verses. Tony asked a good question, that why would Muslims make up such a story? By the principle of embarrassment, Muslims should not want to make up a story that would be embarrassing about the Prophet Muhammad. But then we could ask the same questions about many, many stories that are contained in apocryphal gospels. In the infancy gospel of Thomas, for example, Jesus kills a child. Obviously, the people who wrote these gospels didn't think that they were Muslims. They weren't Buddhists or Hindus. They were self-professed Christians. They were people who believed themselves to be Christians. So why would Christians write a story in the infancy gospel of Thomas that says Jesus killed a child? So by the principle of embarrassment, if you want to apply it that way, we should accept that that must be historically true. Jesus must have killed a child. You mentioned Uthman, how Uthman, this was the third caliph of Islam, he standardized the Quran. What are the credentials of Uthman, though? Who is Uthman? Uthman is not just the third caliph. He is an eyewitness disciple. He is a companion of the Prophet Muhammad. He is a son-in-law of the Prophet Muhammad. He married not one, but two daughters of the Prophet, not at the same time. The Prophet Muhammad said, Uthman fil Jannah. Uthman is guaranteed paradise. He's guaranteed heaven. So we have our Prophet attesting to the character of this man, Uthman, who standardized the Quran. Moreover, Uthman didn't act by himself. He appointed a committee. That committee had Ubay bin Ka'b on it. That committee had Zayd bin Thabit on it. Who's Zayd bin Thabit? Zayd bin Thabit is the same Zayd bin Thabit that when Abu Bakr wanted to write a mushaf, a compilation of the Quran in one place, a book of the Quran, he asked Zayd bin Thabit to do it. Before him, Zayd bin Thabit was a scribe of the Prophet. So even when the Prophet was reciting the Quran, Zayd bin Thabit was one of the men that was writing it down. So Zayd bin Thabit during the time of the Prophet, Zayd bin Thabit during the time of Abu Bakr, Zayd bin Thabit during the time of Uthman. Same guy, going all the way back to the time of the Prophet. Moreover, unlike the Bible, Muslims have a concept of the revelation of the Quran, which is that it was revealed in variants. We actually believe that the variants are divinely revealed. To give you an example of how that might work, we all know the English alphabet here, A, B, C, all the way to X, Y, Z. But some people say X, Y, Z, right? So are they wrong? Is it X, Y, Z, or is it X, Y, Z? Are we going to fight about it? No, both of them are correct. Both of them are acceptable. So they are not competing readings. Tony used the word competing. They're not competing readings. They're complementary readings, just like X, Y, Z, X, Y, Z. It's not a fight or a dispute. Regarding the Shias believing that Ali had a different Quran, it's actually not true. If you speak to any 12er, any Ithna Ashari Shia today, they will say that what Uthman did is correct, and they have the same Quran as us. When you go to Iran, it is the same Arabic Quran in Shia Iran as you have in Sunni Saudi Arabia. Moreover, Ali was the fourth caliph of Islam. He was the fourth leader, the fourth khalifa of Islam. So had he believed that the Quran had been changed, don't you think he would change it back at the time that he was the leader of the Islamic world? That would make sense. Keith Small, Tony quoted from this book, or he referenced this book, Textual Criticism and Quran Manuscripts by Keith Small. Keith Small, I'm sorry, does not know Arabic. Keith Small does not reference any primary works in here. He doesn't reference any primary Arabic works here. So Keith Small is completely ignoring the Islamic tradition. He's working with that. Tony earlier on mentioned that in the Quran, God is called the best of creators. Not sure where he was going with that, but if he was pointing towards henotheism is the idea that there's many gods, but I might just choose to worship one of those many gods. I'm just worshiping one of them exclusively. That, of course, would be wrong, because there's so many other verses that make it clear that there's no other God except the one God. La ilaha illallah. This is very clear in the Quran. If you want to cut and paste and take one verse like that out of context, because we are creators as well, too. We all create as well, too. But God is the best of creators because he creates out of nothing. We can't create out of nothing. We can't create the heavens and the earth from nothing. God does that. That's why he's the best of creators. And if you're going to cut and paste like that, what would you make of Psalm 86, verse 8, where it says, among the gods, there is none like you. Does that mean that there are many gods? Is that henotheism in the Bible? What about Daniel 2, 47, in Aramaic, where it calls God, Ilah Ilahin. Ilah Ilahin, the God of gods. Are there many gods in the Bible? I don't think you want to argue for that kind of plurality in the Old Testament concept of God.
Thank you very much. Can we give a round of applause for both Sadat and Tony? Thank you, guys. That was very engaging, and we appreciate it. So we're going to take the next 30 minutes for some Q&A. I'm going to be asking questions for both of these men, and each of them have 2 minutes to respond to the question. Now, these questions are pretty deep. They're pretty tough. Sadat, the first one is for you. Are you ready? The first question is, what is Sadat drinking? What is in there?
Do you have a mic or something? It's right behind you. I think you're sitting on it. Yeah, there you go.
I promise it's is that working? Yeah, it is non-alcoholic, and that's all you need to know. Brewed in Mississauga.
The first question is, and this is a question for both of you, was Jesus a Muslim or Muslim?
Yeah, okay, excellent question. I'm glad it came up again because Tony mentioned that the Quran is rewriting history. The Quran is rewriting the whole narrative because it presents all of the prophets as being Muslims. Now, when you first hear that, it sounds wrong to the ears because you're like,
Moses wasn't speaking Arabic. Moses wasn't reciting the Quran. Moses didn't go to Mecca to do the Hajj or the pilgrimage. So how could he have been a Muslim? The Quran is obviously messing that up. No, you have to understand with every book how the author uses its term, how the author uses his terms. In the Quran, the sun is a Muslim. The moon, the mountains, the trees, they're all Muslim. Does that mean that the trees are speaking Arabic and reading the Quran and wearing something like this? No, of course not. It is in the generic sense. The generic sense meaning that Muslim means one who submits. So the trees submit to the will of God. The sun submits to the will of God. The moon submits to the will of God. So in that sense, because Jesus submitted his will to God, Moses submitted his will to God, Abraham submitted his will to God, in that sense, they were Muslims. They were submitters. And certainly they were more Muslim than they were Christian, because you can't show me where Moses was worshiping the Son of God. You can't show me where Job was worshiping the Son of God or worshiping a Trinity. So the idea is not far off when you understand it in that context.
Am I on? You can hear me, okay. Jesus of Nazareth was a first century Mediterranean Jew, and he began a following in the first century. We know this from the earliest documents we have for Jesus are the New Testament documents. He was a Mediterranean Jew who was Torah observant. He observed the Torah. He believed in the Torah. He believed in the Holy Scriptures, the Hebrew Scriptures that we call the Old Testament. And Jesus of Nazareth understood that his mission was to come, as he said, to give his life as a ransom for many. We do know that this Jesus, according to the New Testament Gospels and the extra-biblical sources outside of the New Testament, attests that Jesus was crucified under Pontius Pilate in Judea. This is a point that the Quran denies. Wa ma salabahu, wa ma katalahu. They certainly did not crucify him. They certainly did not kill him. And that this Jesus was raised from the dead. And the early Christians believed that he was the Son of God. They believed that he was the promised Messiah. Was he worshipped? Absolutely. The New Testament text clearly demonstrates that in the early Christian church, Jesus was an object of worship. They prayed to him. The Maranatha prayer in the New Testament is an Aramaic word that means, "Our Lord, come." And we know that they sang hymns to him. We know that they prayed to him, the Stephen martyr. The Acts 7 mentions this, the martyr Stephen, as he's being stoned to death. He calls on the Lord Jesus, says, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit and do not hold us against them." The New Testament is very, very clear that the Jesus of history was the Messiah, that he was believed to be the Lord, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. That is a completely different picture of what we see in the Quran. In the Quran, he is a Muslim who points the way to Muhammad. And he only comes in a very restricted sense to the Jews. The Jesus of the New Testament comes to the Jews, but then sends the disciples into all the world to preach his gospel.
Thank you. This question is specifically for Sadat, but Tony, if you would like to comment, you can as well. Does Allah enter into personal relationships with humans? Can a Muslim really say, "I love Allah"?
Yeah, I would actually say that shirk is the word that means idolatry, polytheism, associating partners with God in worship. Shirk is the unpardonable sin in the Quran. It's the greatest sin that you can commit, to worship anything other than God, to worship a human being. This is the greatest sin you can commit in the Quran. One of the reasons that this is a sin is because it's actually interfering in that relationship that you have with God. Your relationship with God should be a direct one. Your relationship with what Muslims call Allah, and I believe Christians call God the Father, that relationship should be a pure, direct relationship that doesn't require intercession or, you know, intercessors. So absolutely, the Muslims believe that they do have a personal, loving relationship with God. And to give you an example, in chapter 2, verse 186 of the Quran, that it says that when my servant asks about me, say to him that I am close. I'm Qareeb. Al-Qareeb, the close, is one of the names of God in the Quran. Al-Wali, the friend, the protecting friend. This is one of the names of God in the Quran. So absolutely, we do believe that we have that relationship.
I would say that the concept of covenant, as I mentioned earlier, is something that begins in Genesis and works its way out throughout the whole Bible. God enters into relationship with us, and it's very intimate. It's not a master-slave relation, as you see in Islam. It is a father-child relationship. One of the closest intimate words we could use in relationship is that of a loving father towards a son, towards a daughter. And Jesus revealed God in his great love for us as father. The other thing we have to bear in mind is that the love of God in the Bible is unconditional. God loved sinners when sinners were his enemies. God displayed his love towards us that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. The Bible says we did not first love him, he first loved us. In the Quran, Allah's love is conditional. He'll only love you if you love the messenger first and obey him. So in Surah 331, it says, Muhammad says, if you love me, say, if you love me, then follow me and Allah will love you and forgive you. So notice that the love of Allah, the forgiveness of Allah is conditional upon you submitting and following the messenger. In the New Testament, again, it's the other way around. We did not first love God, God first loved us. And that is amazing grace. That is amazing love. And the other thing, too, is the Quran says that Allah is closer to you than your jugular vein. But if you read the rest of the verse, there's a veiled threat there that he is closer to you than your jugular. But God can at any time cut that jugular and bring you into judgment and so forth. So the master-slave relationship is fundamental to Islam. But in Christianity, I see this God who cares for us. Jesus presents himself as one who came to seek and to save that which was lost. He didn't wait for me to come to him. Out of his great mercy, out of his great grace, he came to me. And that's why I love him. I love Jesus Christ because he came looking for me. He didn't wait for me to come to him. And that is my prayer, that you come to know that beautiful relationship. Jesus said that eternal life is to know you, the one true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent.
Okay. This question, the last one was for Sadat. This one is for Tony. You can feel free to respond to this as well. Tony, why can't God just forgive sins? Why is it out of his limits?
The God of the Bible is not just a God of mercy, but the God of the Bible is also a God of justice. And this is something, the Quran, I think, mentions Allah's holiness. He's Al-Quds, the Holy One. He's only mentioned twice. The holiness of God, if you do a search on holiness or holy in the Bible, it's all over the place. God's holiness is such that the righteous demands of his law must be met. And so he cannot just wink at sin and let it go. What I see in the sacrifice of Jesus is both the mercy of God and the justice of God. Islam has never been able to reconcile the justice of God with his mercy. Christianity says that at the cross, both mercy and justice meet. God displays his love towards sinners, and Christ pays the penalty for our sins. And so the concept of sin is also something that is extremely serious in the Bible. In Islam, Adam slipped up. He made a mistake. Man is forgetful. Allah forgives, and Adam moves on. But in the Bible, the concept of God's justice is extremely central. That's why you have the concept of sacrifice in the Old Testament. That's why you have the concept of God's justice through the sacrifice of Jesus in the New Testament. So this concept of sacrifice, while it is alien to Islam, is extremely central to Judaism and Christianity. Our Jewish friends last night started celebrating the Passover. And what was the Passover celebration all about? Incidentally, the Quran says nothing about these Jewish feasts at all. The Passover was the great act of deliverance when God redeemed the people of Israel out of slavery and bondage from Egypt. And what was the redeeming quality? What saved them from the angel of death was they took the blood of the lamb and they put it on the doorposts of their house. That's where we get the word Passover. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. The New Testament tells us that Jesus Christ, when John the Baptist, whom our Muslim friends know as Yahya, when John the Baptist saw Jesus, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world."
Tony, you're out of time on that. Would you like to respond to that? I have a question that's actually really similar, though.
Yes, if I may, please, if
yeah,
I can.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is that, as I said, outside of the realm of abstract Christian theology,
Even Christians do not abide by these concepts of justice and forgiveness. Supposing somebody punched me and injured me and caused me to have a bloody nose. Quranically speaking, I have two options, you know, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. I could strike him back, yeah, not kill his family or anything, but I can punch him back, give him a bloody nose and say, there you go, tit for tat, you know, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. That's justice. Or I could say, I forgive you. Forgiveness means I let you go. It's okay. You know, what's a punch between two friends and forget about it. What I cannot do, what is not logical, is that I punch him back, give him a bloody nose and say, now I forgive you. No, that's not forgiveness because I got my blood, I got my revenge, I got my vengeance, I took out my anger, right? So for me, in the New Testament, God the Father is getting his blood payment. He's getting his ransom, he's getting his payment, then he's letting you go. That for me is not forgiveness, and punishing an innocent person is not justice. So far from justice and forgiveness being reconciled at the cross, I see that neither one is being fulfilled. And in terms of the master-servant relationship, Job, Moses, Isaac, all of these prophets in the Old Testament are called Evid. Evid is the same as the Arabic Abd, which can mean slave, it can also mean servant. So I'm in good company. If I'm a slave or a servant of God, I'm in good company. I don't find it demeaning or denigrating in any way.
Thank you. I'm going to raise a question that follows along this, and then I'll move away from these questions. And again, Tony, you can feel free to respond to this if you like. This was specifically sent in for Sadat. Can God just forgive? And then followed up is, do you think that you deserve forgiveness?
You're right, that's a related question. So I already answered that question, because if God could not forgive like that, then think about it. The implications of that are that you and I are actually more forgiving than God. You and I are actually more forgiving than God, because this guy punched me, right? He gave me a bloody nose, and I'm just going to forget about it. I'm going to wipe the slate clean. So if I can do that, how come God can't do that? Muslims believe God can do that. In fact, he can do that far better and in greater, you know, quantity than we can. You see, again, look, and in terms of Muslims not taking sin seriously, just to bounce off of that, is that, you know, I have an 8-year-old son. He's here in the audience, right? If I expect him to meet my standards all the time, if I say, look, son, run and jump over this chair, because I can, I think I can. So since I can, you're my son, I want you to be like me, you have to live up to my standards, you should be able to jump over this chair too. And when he fails, sorry, son, the relationship is over, that's it. I mean, you know, you fell short of my expectations. All of you here would probably think I'm a psychotic dad if I did that. So this is the problem that I see, that for an infallible God to expect Tony and Sadat to be infallible, that would be unjust, because we're not infallible. So if God expected us to be infallible, he would basically be expecting us to be God. God would be expecting Adam to not be Adam, he would be expecting Adam to be God.
Thank you. Sadat, would you like to respond to that?
Yeah, let me just say that I'm not opposed to the servant language. I mean, the Bible was using this language long before Muhammad or the Quran. And so the idea of one of the honorific titles of the Messiah in Isaiah 53 is that he's the servant of the Lord. He's the slave of the Lord. But what Islam does is Islam reduces it to just that basic master-slave relationship. In the Bible expands further and shows that we're not just servants of God, but we are also children of God through Jesus Christ. Now, the problem here, I think Sadat is missing, is that I'm not expecting my children. I have three of them, and I got to meet Sadat's cool little boy over there. He's a charming young man. I wouldn't expect my children to achieve infallible requests from me or achieve that which they cannot do. That's precisely why Jesus came. The Bible says we have all sinned. We have all come short of the glory of God. We've all missed the mark. That's the point, is when we were weak, when we couldn't do it, God sent forth his son, and his son paid the price for us. There was a payment that had to be made to the justice of God, and Jesus Christ met that payment. Now, that is the storyline of the Bible, whether Sadat wants to accept it or not. He's reacting to that because of what the Quran says, but the Bible's very clear that God is a God of justice, that God does provide atonement. Even the whole beautiful story of Abraham taking up his son to Mount Moriah to offer him up. Today in Judaism, the Jews regard that act known as the Akedah, the binding of Isaac. They consider the fact that God is merciful to Israel based on the fact that Isaac was willing to lay down his life willingly on that altar. And the picture there we see is of the father giving up his one and only son. And this points forward, of course, to the New Testament with the giving of God's son, the Lord Jesus Christ. But that's the point, folks, is God is not waiting back like a fiend and saying, okay, jump through the hoops, let's go, let's see you go. God says, look, you couldn't do it.
And time's up, Tony.
He sent Christ to do that for us.
Thank you. Next question is a little bit, quite a bit different. This is, I'm sure both of you would like to respond to this. Should we read the Quran literally, or is it open to interpretation? We'll start with you, Sadat.
Yeah, this is the great problem that faces every religious scripture, really. When do you take it literally, and when do you take it figuratively? The Quran itself indicates that some of its verses are clear, and they're meant to be even legal commandments. And then some of them are mutashabihat. You know, they could be allegorical or figurative. So in the Quran, there is figurative language. There is even some anthropomorphic language as well, too. Even God being referred to as a king, you could object to even that. Maliki Yawmiddin, the king of the day of judgment. Well, these are approximations. This word is not meant to be taken literal nor figurative. It's an approximation. It's giving you some kind of an idea of what God is like. And that's why even the scripture is not the final word. The Quran doesn't explicitly say that God is like a loving parent, but you do find that idea that he is that protecting friend. He's al-wali. He is the ar-rab. He's the sustainer. Those are concepts of what, you know, your parents do. But the Quran hasn't reduced it just to a master-servant thing, because Tony keeps on coming back to that. I just want to respond. You see, again, to use the example of my son, I'm buddies with my son. Me and my son are good pals, right? I call him buddy all the time, but I don't let him call me buddy. I don't let him call me buddy. And the reason for that is not because he's not my buddy or not because he's not my friend, but because I want to maintain that clear hierarchy. Because despite all the current political correctness, there is a hierarchy, and the father is in charge of the son, you know, in our home. So I don't let him call me buddy, even though I am like a buddy. Similarly, God is like a loving parent in the Quran, but we don't call him God the Father for the same reason that we don't call him God the Mother. And such terms do lead to a slippery slope whereby eventually the idea that somebody is not only a figurative son of God, but is a literal, begotten, eternal son of God. This is how Muslims believe Christians fell into the whole problem.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I would agree that we need to interpret the text based on a proper exegesis or hermeneutics. The Bible is the same thing. It uses anthropomorphisms for God. It uses zoomorphisms, where God is applied to a protecting hen that covers us with his feathers and with his wings, etc. But you see, the issue here is that the whole language of father, which Muslims are very uncomfortable with, because the Quran makes it very clear that there's none like him. There's nothing comparable to Allah. The language of father, of course, is not literal as well. The language of father tries to convey that intimate relationship that God enters into with us. And this language pervades the whole Bible, not just the New Testament, but in the Old Testament, we're told that Israel as a corporate nation is the son of God. The angels are called Bene Elohim, the sons of God. In the New Testament, believers in Jesus Christ are called children of God. Christ makes us children of God. And so we have the most intimate relationship with the Father. But no one walks away from this thinking, well, since I'm a child of God, therefore I must be a God myself. No one walks away thinking of that. We understand that the fatherhood of God is not literal. We know we're adopted as God's children. And so while God is, yes, our Lord, yes, he is our master, these are all biblical terms, the most affectionate term that we could use is that of a parental parent. We call God Father. Why do we call God Father? Because Jesus taught us that. One of the most famous prayers in the Christian church. We all know it, right? We all call it the Lord's Prayer. But it's not really the Lord's Prayer. It's the disciples' prayer. Jesus taught it. And you know the prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. This is central to the Christian message. That God is not just transcendent, but that God is immanent. God has come to us in the person of his Son. And he desires to enter into a wonderful relationship with you and give you assurance of your sins forgiven and eternal life.
Great, thank you. This question was sent in for Tony, but I think it's a great question for both of you to answer. So we'll start with you, Sadat. The question was asked, what specifically for Tony, what is your opinion, what in your opinion is the strongest case for Islam? So I'll ask you, Sadat, in your opinion, what do you think is the strongest case for Christianity? What's the strongest case for Christianity? And for Tony, he's going to answer, what's the strongest case for Islam?
Well, that is a difficult question. I mean, we should change seats, I guess. Let's switch. I mean, you know, I'm shooting myself in the foot. I mean, if I wasn't a Muslim, if I was just an agnostic or an atheist, then the beautiful life example of Jesus would be one reason that I should consider the Bible's testimony about Jesus. And the Christian version of Jesus. I would listen to you because of what I see in Jesus' life. And of course, Muslims don't deny any of that. For Muslims, of course, Jesus is a sinless prophet. So I think those teachings are very beautiful. The general ethical teachings and the golden rule and things like that. Although these are common to many other faith communities as well.
Thank you. Tony, what's the strongest case?
You're sounding just like a brother there, Sadat. I pray that will be true one day. Okay. Let me just say that is a difficult question. But the only thing I could say, the most positive thing I would say about Islam is it's challenged me to actually learn Arabic. So I'm studying Arabic right now. And the reason why I do that is I earnestly want to be able to study the Quran in its original language and also be able to communicate with my Muslim friends more clearly. And I've been doing this for many years. I love my Muslim friends. We may disagree with our ideologies, we may disagree theologically, but at the end of the day, we're all children of Adam. And at the end of the day, we are human beings, we are responsible to our Creator, and my call in this regard is to love Sadat, and I honestly do. He's a dear friend of mine. I have high regard for him and his family and his friends from the masjid. But it has encouraged me to delve more into the Arabic language and to understand the Quran better in its original context.
Great, thank you. We have another question that was sent in that I think would be good for both of you to respond to. Sadat, we'll start with you. This question was directed to you. According to Muslims, what is God the one of? One essence, one of person? Question marks on both those.
Yeah, he's one in essence because he has one dhat, one essence. Of course, there's a certain kind of plurality within that concept because he has many attributes. He speaks, he hears, he sustains, he creates, he destroys. So he has many attributes, but the essence is one. That's the best that I can answer it. In terms of this English word person, I'm still struggling with it because to my knowledge in the Islamic tradition, God is not referred to as a shakhs, as a person, but sometimes for the purpose of comparison, when I'm talking to a Trinitarian Christian, just by way for purposes of convenience, I might say that God is one person. We believe God is one person. But in Muslim circles, I might hesitate to say that because that might have its own implications, which I'm not familiar with. You know.
So if you could respond in Christianity, what is the understanding of God being one?
Yeah, the understanding of God is that God is one in essence. God is one in his nature. But within the Christian framework, there's an understanding of plurality within God, that there is three persons in the one God, not three persons in one person, not three gods in one God, but three persons in the nature, in the one essence of God. And of course, there is a sense, the Bible also says that God is not comparable to anything. So folks, please don't use the ice, water, steam argument. Don't use the eggshell and the yolk and the white, because there's nothing comparable in this world to the Almighty. And so we have to be very careful there. And so the complexity of God's unity in the Bible is very different than Islam. In Islam, it's tawhid, it's this absolute unity, but at the same time, you cannot comment on what God is, because to do so brings you close to comparing him to something which could be shirk. So there's always that alertness within Islam. But in the Christian faith, the idea is that God is complex in his nature. The idea of God is love, and I'm sure you've heard this before, St. Augustine made this very famous, that the reason why God can be, the Bible says God is love, is because in order for love to function, there has to be at least a subject and an object. You have to love someone, and you have to be loved by someone. In a Unitarian framework, that's not possible. In a Unitarian framework, God has to make something to be in relationship to, which says that God then has to become dependent. He becomes dependent on something. He can't be dependent on himself because there's no other. And so he has to create something, and therefore a Unitarian God becomes dependent on creation. The biblical God doesn't need you. He doesn't need us. He doesn't need creation. He is eternally fulfilled within himself. He's eternally loving, and that's because within God there is an eternal community. And that's why Jesus can say that the Father has loved him and that he shared that glory eternally with the Father. And this is something that is profound, that the basis of our love, the basis of the concept of love, the basis of communication is rooted in this God who is the eternal communicator within the persons of the Holy Trinity.
Thank you for that. I realize that, the Quran accepts that Jesus was sinless, but this is for you, Sadat, but Muslims also accept that Muhammad was not. Therefore, why is Muhammad considered to be a greater prophet than Jesus?
Not exactly related to the Quran, but no, Muslims don't believe that Prophet Muhammad committed sins. So there's a false assumption in the question. Muslims believe that all of the prophets were sinless. But how you define sinless can have some nuanced differences between different groups of Muslims. So the majority believe that the prophets were sinless, period, but they could make mistakes. They could make errors in judgment or discretion, but those don't count as sins, because it comes back to how you define sin. And sin in Islam is a purposeful violation of a law of God. A purposeful violation of a law of God. So you have to know that this is a law, you have to purposely go against it, then it's a sin. So whereas there are some Muslims who would say that prophets could commit minor sins, but it's really just a difference of semantics, because when you ask them to define minor sins, what they mean by that is errors that God didn't speak about. God didn't lay down a law about a certain matter, and they acted on their own discretion, and that's that.
Do you want to respond to that?
Sure. That's a very interesting point that was brought up. Many scholars, John Montgomery Watt and many others who've studied in Islam, have argued that the idea of the sinlessness of the prophets is something that developed within Islamic tradition and theology. Just like the idea of the eternal, the kalimatullah, the eternal speech of God, is something that developed within Islamic tradition, particularly against the Mu'tazilites, who were arguing that the Quran was not eternal. The interesting thing, though, is that Jesus is the only prophet in the Quran who is without sin. Interesting. He is blameless. He is the only one who's called the word from Allah. He's a Hebrew, a spirit from Allah. And what is interesting, though, is that the Quran does, in fact, command Muhammad to ask forgiveness for his sins. It's in the Quran. Ask forgiveness for your sins. And there is a hadith that actually records that Muhammad said, I confess my sins up to 70 times a day. And I ask that Allah will scatter my sins as far as the east is from the west. And so I think there is an acknowledgement of sin within the Islamic tradition of Muhammad. And I think it's also interesting that in Shia Islam, this is a very strong doctrine of the sinlessness of the prophets, very prevalent in Shia Islam. But I think the Quran itself openly admits that Muhammad was told by Allah to confess your sins. But this raises another interesting question. Why is it that Jesus is very different in the Quran? This man who's mentioned 25 times and is said to be a virgin born of a virgin, he is said to be a prophet who does these miracles, of course, in the Quran by Allah's leave. He is a very unique individual in the Quran. But scholars like Professor Khalidi wrote a book called The Muslim Jesus. And in that book, he actually argues, which is very, very provocative, that the Muslim Jesus, he says, is an argument. That he is an argument, and actually, he argues that the Muslim Jesus is meta-historical. He's not in any way, shape, or form like the Jesus of history that we know him to be.
How much time do we have left? According to my watch, we have 1 minute. So I'm going to ask one last question then, and we'll wrap up with this. Is that fair? We asked you what's the greatest evidence for the other side. Why don't we end by you answering what do you believe is the greatest evidence for Islam? And you can end with that, and you can end with what do you think is the greatest evidence for Christianity?
Well, I mean, I would love to repeat all the points that I brought up in my introduction, but to throw out something different, I would say that the Quran has stood the test of time, beginning with its own followers. So, whereas in the case of the Bible, it's Judeo-Christian scholarship itself that is kind of tearing it apart now. It's not Muslims who are doing studies on the Gospel of John. It's not Muslims who posited the documentary hypothesis for the Old Testament about how it was authored. It's people from the Judeo-Christian tradition, and liberal Christians as well, too, who have done scholarship on the Bible, and they're saying, yeah, Gospel of John was redacted many times over. It had different authors. There's no way the Torah could have been written by the historical Moses. This is what Judeo-Christian scholars are saying. Whereas faith has held up much better in the Muslim world. If you line up 10 guys named Michael and ask them if they believe the Bible is the inerrant word of God, you and I all know that maybe, right? Maybe two out of those 10 Michaels maybe are believing Christians and take the Bible very seriously. The majority don't. But you line up 10 guys named Ahmed, right? Or line up 10 ladies named Fatima and ask them, is the Quran the inerrant word of God? And did God speak to Prophet Muhammad? And so forth. And the answer is in the affirmative, you know. It might be a drug dealer, Ahmed, right? But their faith is intact. So thus far, Islam has fared much better on that level. And in fact, you really have to scrape to try to find Muslims, even in the Western world, where they're free. They're not scared about their life. It's hard to find Muslim scholars that poke the same kind of holes, you know, in the Quran that Christian scholars do. Just right now, Tony mentioned Tarif Khalidi. Tarif Khalidi is apparently, he's saying, a Muslim scholar who, you didn't say it explicitly, I want to be fair, but since the topic is the Quran and the Bible, the implication is that he's questioning the Quranic Jesus. But no, Tarif Khalidi, I have the book here, right in the introduction, he makes it clear that the Quranic Jesus and the Muslim Jesus are two different things because...
We're out of time.
Okay, but he defines it as something that is post-Islam.
Okay.
And what was the question again? What was the...
What do you think is the greatest evidence for Christianity? Is for you.
Okay, all right. The greatest evidence for Christianity is the resurrection of Jesus. One of the Christianity either falls or stands on one thing. It's not on whether Jesus was born in the manger. It's not whether Jesus taught in parables. The Christian faith rests on the affirmation that God raised him from the dead. Now, are there scholars out there from the Judeo-Christian tradition that are liberal? Yes. Bart Ehrman is not a conservative scholar. He's not even a believer in God. What do liberal scholars have in common? Well, they don't believe that God has spoken. What's the name of this conference? God has spoken. Has God spoken? We believe he has. But what Sadat's not doing, he's not quoting conservative scholars. There's a lot of conservative scholars out there who have argued very persuasively, that have debunked the documentary hypothesis, that have debunked this whole redaction of John, which is all based on theory and presupposition. There's no evidence in the manuscripts that any redaction like that took place. These are just presuppositions. But the resurrection of Jesus, there's one thing that New Testament scholars are agreed on. If I were to call Bart Ehrman up on the stage right now and say, Bart, do you believe Jesus of Nazareth died on the cross 2,000 years ago? He would say, absolutely. No doubt about it. It's the most historical, certain thing we have about the Christian faith. Jesus died on the cross. Did some of his believers believe that he was raised from the dead? Absolutely. How did Christianity begin? With the proclamation that Jesus was raised from the dead. There's very good historical evidence for the death of Jesus, his honorable burial, the empty tomb discovery, the post-mortem appearances of Jesus, and the origin of the Christian way. The Christian movement, folks, could not have existed with a dead Messiah. The reason why we are here today as Christians, not as Muslims, but as Christians, is because we believe that this one was raised from the dead, that God has raised him and appointed him to be the judge of all the earth. And the promise is this, the grave has been defeated, death has been defeated, there is hope
Tony, you're out
in
of time.
Christ.
Thank you. Can we give a hand for both of them, please? Sadat and Tony, didn't they do a great job tonight? Thank you, men.